So in very many weeks, we're now on to, we finally made it to 1 Corinthians 13, chapter 7. Give yourselves a hand. We're at chapter, or we're at verse 7. Verse 7. It goes, I'll just read the preceding verses for you so you can see how, notice though, the language changes here. Okay, so we have, love is patient, love is kind. It is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. And here's where it changes. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Let's pray. Oh God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts will be acceptable in thy sight. Lord God, you are our strength and our redeemer. May my words not only be mine, oh God, but yours. Amen. One of the things that you will notice about all of these love is, all this stuff in 1 Corinthians, love is this, love is that, love is this, right? They are all action words, okay? These are not properties that love has. These are things that love does. All of them are things that you do, okay? And so what the Bible says about love is something that you do. It is not something that you feel. Okay, that's a part of it, but it is not primarily a feeling. We talked about that at the very beginning, but I just want to reinforce that. These are all action words. Being in ministry, even as long as I have, I've seen many different sides of humanity. One time, I was working with a guy who was very severely drug addicted. He had a very severe addiction problem. And one time, he had spent all his money on drugs, and his daughter had a piggy bank that she was saving up to buy something for herself, and her mother was trying to teach her about how to be, you know, fiscally responsible and to save up for the things she wanted. And he was so drug addicted that he stole his own daughter's piggy bank, all the money that she had saved up to buy drugs for himself. And I heard about this, and I went to go talk to him, and I was like, man, what are you doing? That is awful. How could you do that? And he said, you know, I really love my family. That's what he said. I really love my family, but I don't know why I do these things. And the first thing I said is, no, you don't love your family. I don't care how you feel, but if you do something like that, you do not love your family. Because what 1 Corinthians 13 shows us is that love is an action. It is something that you do. It doesn't matter how you feel. If you do something like that, that's just your way of making yourself feel better about the things that you do. You say, well, I did these, you know, terrible things. I did this. But, you know, I really do love them. And that assuages our guilt a little bit, makes us feel a little bit better. Love is not a feeling to make yourself feel better about what you do. If you don't do the things that love does, you don't love them. That's the bottom line. That's the bottom line. That's what 1 Corinthians 13 is. If you're not patient with people, if you're not kind with people, you can't say that you love them. You can't. It's something that we do. Now, that's the bad news, right? You know, all you're feeling, you're like, oh, well, maybe I won't really love you. The good news, though, is if love is something you can do, it doesn't matter how you feel, you can do it anyway. Whether you feel like you want to or not. Okay? So, you know, you might say, well, I don't know if I really do love them. All you've got to do is do that stuff. Just be kind with them. Be gentle with them. Be patient with them. Be accepting of them. All you got to do is do that stuff, and then you can say that you love them. And it has nothing to do with how you feel. In this crescendo, Paul kind of crescendos in this, like, love is patient, love is kind, you know, we have all these things. And then we get to this part. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. And you see how it changes to have this all things at the end of it, right? And so it's kind of like, now this is the climax of these verses. And to us, that is kind of confusing, right? Because we read those verses like, what does that mean? Love bears all things? Love believes all things? Is love guiltable? Like, does that mean I just have to believe everything I hear because of a I don't believe every word somebody says, but I don't love them. Is that what that means? No, no. These things are, it's kind of deceptive, the language here. And it's not really not a good translation to say all things like that. When it says love bears all things, love believes all things, love hopes all things, love endures all things, really what Paul is saying is that love is the default approach that you should take to all circumstances in life. So if whatever situation that you are going up against, whether it's in a relationship or whether it's something that you're dealing with at work, whether it's something that you're dealing with at school, whether it's anything, Paul says that the way you should start handling that situation is that the first thing that should come to your mind is, how do I love in this situation? How should I handle this situation? Love. So the next time you have a difficult situation, come on, you think, how should I handle this situation? Love. This is the default way that you should approach anything in life. So when Paul says, endures, love bears all things, he's not meaning that you just put up with everything. Because you know, as great as love is, it has abuses. Love has abuses. You want to know more about it? Read C.S. Lewis's The Four Loves. It is a book about when love goes bad. That's the whole book about when people abuse love. Because how many times, you know, I have heard, and I've never said this to anybody, but I've seriously heard women who were in an abusive relationship with their husband, and they come to the pastor to seek help, and the pastor says, well, love bears all things. You just got to put up with it, you know. God forbid you get divorced or something like that. How terrible is that? That's not what Paul is saying at all. Paul is saying that it is love's natural approach to put up with certain things, right? To put up with certain things. For example, we all have our quirks, okay? I have my quirk. I'm kind of weird, okay? I just am. My wife puts up with that, you know, sometimes. I'm really excited about a video game. She doesn't care about the video game, but she listens to me talking about it. She's like, oh, that's really fun. That's really interesting, right? Because she's bearing with me. Okay, even through my quirks and my weirdness. Okay? And love, saying love bears all things. That is the way that love bears all things. Okay? Love is safe. It doesn't go, just because you're weird or just because you have this thing about you, I'm done with you. Love doesn't do that. Love bears all things. Now don't take this too extreme though and think, well, you know, I'm in this abusive relationship, I'm in this really bad situation. Sometimes you've got to cut people off, but just because love bears all things doesn't mean you put up with everything. You've got to get out sometimes because people will take advantage of the fact that love wants to bear all things. So you've got to keep that in mind. Love bears all things to an extent, right? Love believes all things. Remember, this is an approach, right? So it's not saying that I have to believe everything you say. Because I don't know if you've watched TV or gone on the internet, there's a lot of BS, for lack of a better word, on the internet, like, and TV. You know, we live in the information age, which is great. This is what we call this, you know, we went from the nuclear age to the information age, where used to nuclear was the power. You know, Russia and the U.S. had nuclear and it was the power. Now information is power, right? And the internet is great. But the thing about the internet is it collects all information, whether it's true or not, okay? So it's like the aggregate of all human knowledge and stupidity at the same time, okay? And so, no, Paul's not saying be gullible. Really, in the word believe in Greek, it's a verb. So really, what Paul is saying is love faith all things. That's how you could kind of love faiths all things. So in the approach, this approach of life that Paul is talking about, the better translation would be to say, love has faith in all things. Okay? That is the way you approach it. You approach whatever situation that you're in through the eyes of faith. That's what love does. Okay? Love approaches things through the eyes of faith. Love hopes all things. Because if we have faith, hope comes from faith. Okay? In the Bible, that is the distinction. Hope comes from faith. Because if you have faith that Christ is risen, then you have hope that we will be risen too. And your hope comes from that faith, right? So hope. Love has hope in all things. Love approaches every situation with hope. That's the one I really have trouble with because I like to be negative. I like to be cynical, you know, and I'm like, well, this is going to turn out horrible. And then I hope I'm surprised later, you know. I'm like, this is going to be awful. And then when it's good, I'm like, oh, that wasn't so horrible. You know, so I have trouble like having hope in all things. But I try to arrange myself. But, because the last thing somebody wants, you know, if somebody's going through a difficult situation, think about this. If they come to you like, man, I'm just really having a hard time. It's awful. What if you were that way, like, what if the way I am with myself, like, oh, this is going to be, what if I was that way to everybody? I'm like, oh, yeah, you're just in trouble. That's terrible. It's going down here. That's not helpful to people, right? They need to hear a message of hope and love. No, and you need to tell people you are going to make it. And it's going to be okay because we approach all situations. Because we approach all situations with faith. And from our faith comes our hope. Right? Love endures all things. Love endures all things. It's very similar to how love bears all things. But think about how strong real love is. Think about how strong real love is. And you know real love when you see it by the way it endures. You know, Jamie just lost her grandmother, and she hung on for a really long time, and she was safe. Jamie stayed there every day, almost all day for 2 weeks. You know, and nobody starts out in a relationship of thinking about people you love going, man, I really want to sit in a hospital, in an uncomfortable hospital room for 2 weeks and not get any sleep and watch my loved one suffer and die. And it's very painful to me and very. Nobody starts off saying, that's exactly what I want to do. Nobody wants to do that. But you can tell how love somebody is like that. That is love. Right there, when you will sit in a hospital room beside someone. You know, I knew that my dad loved his mom, my grandmother that just passed away. They took care of her, even though she had no idea who she was for 7 years. That's love. That's when you see love endures all things. And that is when you think of it. You know, have you ever seen the movie Hunting? You know, where Will in the movie says, Robin Williams' character has lost his wife to cancer, and Will has these attachment issues, and he's so afraid to love anybody because he's afraid they're going to lose her. And he knows that Robin Williams' character has lost his wife to cancer, and so he says, do you ever regret loving her? And Robin Williams says, what? Because I would lose her? He says, I don't regret being married to her for 18 years. I don't regret the 6 years that I sat in the hospital with her, and I certainly don't regret the last 2 years when she wasn't even conscious because she was dying. I don't regret a dang thing, he says. Love endures all things. Love endures all things. And we've been talking a lot about love and what it means for us to love one another. But in closing, I want to tell you how much God loves us. Because we've been talking a lot about how we love one another. But 1 John says that God is love. And that God encapsulates love itself. And so God does bear all things when it comes to us. The scripture says that God is forgiving, and that God in Christ Jesus bore the sins of the world upon himself. God bears all things. And can you imagine, I don't know, have you ever had this phenomenon where you know how to do something really well and the other person doesn't, but you want them to do it? This is this way with my dad in bowling. My dad was really good at bowling, really good, and he does it all the time. And he wanted me to be a bowler. And the reason I'm not a bowler is because my dad was really good at it, and he would try to teach me. He'd be like, "You're not doing it right. Do it this way." I'm like, "I don't know what you're talking about, Dad." I do this with video games. You know, when somebody's playing a video game that I know how to do, I'm like, "You're not doing it right. You need to jump up there and do this thing. Use that gun, not that gun. That gun's not good." You know, that's and so you get really impatient. So imagine if we're made in the image of God, if God has that same feeling about us, when God like creates us and has this kind of like idea about what we're going to do, and then God's like, "No, you're not doing it right. I created you to be good, and here you are murdering each other and stuff. I created you to flourish, and here you are doing all these things that just kill your soul, and you're just dead inside. I didn't create you for that. What are you doing? I created you to be joyful. Why are you watching all these things that scare you? Why are you so scared? Stop it." Right? Think about how frustrated God must be sometimes. But God bears all things and even bore all the sins of the world on him. And we don't think about love believes all things. We don't think about God being having faith. We usually think about having faith in God. But Deuteronomy 7 says, God says, "I am faithful to you, even to the thousandth generation. I am faithful to you." Imagine that, God having faith. And love hopes all things. Romans 8 says, God subjected all things to futility in hope that the children of God would be revealed. Now, we don't normally think about this, but not only do we have faith in God and we have hope, but God has faith in us and has hopes for us. Have you ever thought about that? God has faith and hopes in us. And another way to put it, God believes in you. God believes in you. God created us and knows our potential, and God has faith in us. God has hope for the things that we will do. And of course we know that God endures because God is always there, because God is love. And there's nothing more that helps me love in those times when I really don't feel like doing it than knowing that I am loved. And since we know that love is an action, and sometimes it's hard to do the things that love does, I know it. But in those moments, I think how much I am loved, not only by the people in my family, in my community, in my church, but I am loved by God. God believes in you. God has faith in us. God has hopes for you. And if God believes in you, imagine the thing that we can do if Almighty God has faith in us.